they've sold their soul to the Premier League. I think the weak, the leadership has been weak and also misguided. Sean Harvey, the outgoing chief executive, was praising what was going on at Bury, you know, the new owner and, you know, what his plans were. Now, surely that can't be right. You know, you look at a football club there where the owner bought it for £1, and I don't know if he's doubled his investment on £1. I don't know is the honest answer to that. But we are at a point where the Football League's role is to enable clubs to be so, you know, to be fit for purpose. In other words, to be able to fulfil their fixtures. It looks like by this time tomorrow, four clubs will not be able to start the season on time.
Yeah.
Two through no fault of their own, Wickham and Milton Keynes Dons,
yeah.
And two through the fault of flawed ownership, Bolton and Bury.
And if we're talking about, you know, certain football clubs coming out of the Premier League, you know, with a parachute payments of over £100 million,
yeah.
These aren't the debts for Notts County and for Bury and for Bolton. You know, it might be over the course of a number of years for Bolton, but definitely not for Notts County and Bury. We're talking of debts of like £1 million, £2 million. There's millions and millions of pounds involved in football right at the very top.
Look, the problem we've always had, and this has always been the case, you never know, I'm not talking here about Bury or Bolton specifically, but there have been people who've turned up who've promised everything and delivered nothing. I mean, this has gone on down the years, and it's seemingly that the Football League has never really looked into deal with it properly at the moment. I mean, you know, yes, they're talking here now of suspending them and what have you. It's this sort of fourth, the timer is on. But, you know, unless a club does go down, they'll always think they can survive and they'll always take the chance. And I just don't know whether this is the end game for one. Whatever we feel about those that have supported Bury for a lifetime and those at Bolton Wanderers as well.
Yeah, and what we're talking about is not just the players. You know, you made a really
good
point.
Everybody else.
Yeah,
around the club, isn't it?
It's you know,
there'll be loads of owned money for not just
within
the club.
It'll be the lady in the canteen.
Exactly.
It'll be people like that.
Yeah.
Who are the beating heart of a football club that people never, you know, don't really know. And do owners really care about those people? The current type of person coming into football probably doesn't. And I go back to the fact that the real tragedy in this is that we could be in a situation very soon where there will be a group of individuals who align themselves with a football club. You know, the people who've watched Bury or Bolton, whoever, for their entire lives, having that pleasure taken away from them. And I think that's terrible.
Well, we're going to leave that there at the moment. We'll be following the news, of course, on TalkSport. And TalkSport 2 with their rolling and breaking news. That'll be the first news, I'm sure, anywhere of exactly what happens at Bury tomorrow after that meeting or that occasion. And with Bolton in the future to come as well. In the next part of the programme, we're going to be looking at cricket. We're going to be looking at the Ashes series. And, of course, Michael Calvin, who has worked very closely with Sir Alistair Cook.
Tremets, good afternoon. Coming up, police combat protesters in Hong Kong, and in sport, Bale looks to remain in Spain.
Talk Sport.
But first, police have fired tear gas at protesters in Hong Kong for the second night in a row. A large group of people gathered for a pro-democracy rally against alleged police brutality last weekend. Elsewhere, the man in charge of no-deal Brexit preparations for such a scenario is now a very real prospect. Michael Gove says the government is operating on the assumption the UK will leave the EU without an agreement on the 31st of October. Meanwhile, Paul Scully has announced his new role as deputy chairman of the Conservative Party over on Talk Radio. The Sutton and Cheam MP says Boris Johnson has shown real energy and direction since taking over at number 10.
And actually not just saying, right, this is where we're going, but offering solutions to these the issues wider than just Brexit, looking at domestic agenda, looking at policing, looking at schools and funding and these kind of things that people have been crying out for the last couple of years.
A father whose baby twins died after being left in a hot car has denied manslaughter. The one-year-old boy and girl were left in the vehicle in New York when temperatures reached around 30 degrees Celsius. And a teenager from Essex who scooped almost £1 million in a gaming tournament says he's glad to have shown his mum he wasn't just wasting time in his bedroom. Jaden Ashman came second in the Fortnite World Cup duos in New York.
Talk Sport weather with QuickFit. Going on a road trip? Book your free vehicle safety check first at one of 600 QuickFit centres nationwide and drive away happy.
Rain continues across northern parts of Wales. It's drier elsewhere, though, with the best of any brighter spells in the south.
Talk Sport. Sports update.
With a new Vauxhall Combo Cargo. Now better than ever. With a payload of up to a ton. Why not request a quote? Search Combo Offer.
Gareth Bale's proposed move to Chinese Super League club Jiangsu Suning appears to have fallen through. The Wales winger's reported £1 million a week transfer has been cancelled by Real Madrid, with Bale set to stay with the Spanish giants. Last week, Zinedine Zidane said Bale was very close to leaving and his exit would be best for everyone after omitting him from their pre-season friendly against Bayern Munich. Elsewhere, Liverpool have signed winger Harvey Elliott from Fulham. The 16-year-old made three first-team appearances last season. Elliott became the youngest Premier League debutant in history in May when he played for Fulham against Wolves. Meanwhile, West Ham striker Jordan Hugill has moved to QPR. That's on a season-long loan. Geraint Thomas is ready to hand over his Tour de France crown later on this afternoon. His teammate Egan Bernal is poised to become the youngest winner of the race in over 100 years.
I just said to him, just enjoy it, soak it all up, and don't worry about crying, because all real men cry. No, it's amazing to be a part of. He's a phenomenal athlete, 22. He's got an amazing year ahead of him, and it's just an honour to have been a part of this.
Great Britain's men won gold in the 4x100m medley relay at the World Swimming Championships. It was a third gold at the event for Adam Peaty. The British team's time is a new European record of 3 minutes 28.1 seconds.
pragmatic and say, well, let's get Jofra Archer ready for the second test and just see how we go with the first test.
For me, Chris Wokes, he knows Edgbaston inside out. His batting is stronger as well. I just feel there is the opportunity for him. I mean, Anderson and Broad, Broad's obviously more than done enough to just show that he's fit and focused and ready to go again with all of that. And the pace of Ollie Stone or Sam Curran, who's a really exciting cricketer for me, both with the bat and the ball, that there are these different permutations. We're in a good position, and that's even without the likes of Mark Wood. But it's suddenly changed so quickly, hasn't it? The pace is back again.
Yeah, and I think looking at a broader level, Sags, also, this series is so important for cricket in general, because the World Cup captured the imagination like probably no other sports event I can remember, in terms of just the sheer drama of that. You know, I had a mate, he'd come over from Los Angeles, and we watched the last sort of five overs, and he was gobsmacked. He didn't know what was going on in many ways, no. But he understood that here was raw human drama, and that had a fantastic effect. And I think that's where the Ashes will be important. I think the Ashes, I don't know what you feel, Sags, but I suspect you're the same as I, that I feel that Test cricket is the ultimate platform, the ultimate test, because to use a phrase that Andy Flower used to use, he says it reveals everything about you and your team if you're a captain.
I completely agree with you on that. For me, the Test series is the ultimate test, which it is. It's different. It's people, again, as you were talking about, many other things to do with football. They can't even watch a 90-minute game, the next generation, some of them. But, you know, they will have been introduced to a 50-over game. The T20 is fantastic. The 100, I'm still looking to see exactly how that goes. But it's all part of trying to sort of sell this. I mean, the T20, up and down the land over these 2 weeks when the weather's good, is just a good occasion to go out to and watch. You can't take it completely seriously as cricket, and there's nothing new about T20. I mean, all these players and the generation before were playing that when they first started, perhaps as a youngster in their village, in their clubs, and then onto their counties, and then getting their opportunity at the highest level. Test cricket is still very important, but again, everybody is looking once more at finance and everything that surrounds it, and can we keep going? Because what we don't want to happen to cricket, and it would take it wouldn't take anywhere near as long, to price itself out of the
So they've got to balance that 50 million with the longevity of the game. And as you say, the game is dying out in state schools. It needs heroes. Now, the thing about an Ashes series, it always produces the hero, and it also produces the zero. So it's a really important series for cricket in general. And I just think we're in a stage now where it is really important that this England team fulfills itself and actually is an attractive team to watch and to... Because if you look at the Australians, you know, there's this great headline, and I think it was the Australian the other day, they're getting the band back together again, BANNED. So you've got all the sort of sandpaper gate stuff and all the ball tampering and everything else. That's going to be in there. It's got all the right ingredients for a soap opera that we need, that cricket needs, to actually basically get out of the ghetto that it's perhaps going into.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the likes of Stark, Cummins and Hazelwood and Nathan Lyon and all the others that were involved, and then the great batsmen you mentioned there, the band, ED, and David Warner, of course, and everybody else that were involved in that, Steve Smith and everything else that came to pass with all of that. But for me, it's more than that now. Just a final thought on this, and we won't go into too much depth here at all because we can't. We've got other things we want to talk about. But Sir Alistair Cook, you know, there is a man who, if you ever want to follow a role model within a sporting context, he is the man, and you've worked very closely with him.
Yeah, I collaborated with Cookie on his autobiography, which, to get the plug in, is out on September the 5th, folks.
That's fine.
It was a really pleasurable experience, and it's quite... He has a humility. When we get together, you know, he looked at some of the other co-writes that I'd done with people like Gareth Thomas and Joey Barton, and he said, look, there's been no trauma in my life. There's no been... But he was almost doubting whether he would be interesting to people. And I just said, well, mate, you cannot have done what you've done by being, you know, this sort of, you know, bland figure that you tend to think you might be. And when you actually dig deep into him and you talk about the psychology of performance under pressure, which is what he has done, he did over 13 years, he is... In terms of, you know, we always have this debate, you know, who are our greatest living athletes? Well, Andy Murray is right up there for me, but I think Alistair Cook is close to that, because when you look at what he's achieved, and he's done what you as a football manager, Sean, would love, I'm sure, he has made the absolute most of his talent.
Because I think the only other thing that I can think about is, in a similar sense as an opening batsman, would be somebody on the blocks in 100 metres where they perhaps have a bad start or a double false start and they're out. As an opening batsman, the end game can come at the very start. And it's not just over and then your opportunity, let's say in the second inning straight away or in the next game. It's you've got to go out and suffer and have all of that thought while everything else is going.
we'll find out about him.
What I've also rather liked about England this time around, with the English scandals that we had with Ben Stokes and the lack of vigilance and therefore what they did and punished for that, he's been made vice captain for this series. He's proved to, I think, everybody that he is now worthy of being very much part once more. And for me, that is also something we mustn't forget. You know, these are all young men and women who are playing our professional sport. They're bound to make mistakes both on and off the field. And if they show willing enough to get themselves back together, if it's the right time, and I think this is the right time, for instance, to give Ben Stokes the opportunity of taking over from Jos Buttler as vice-captain of England, then so be it. And that, for me, is another mark just ahead of this series, which I like to see with our cricket.
Yeah, and you can probably, link it into other sports where someone like Ben Stokes has had to grow up in public, and he's made mistakes in doing so. But now, if you look at him, he is he's like an amalgamation of all his experience now. So, essentially, in those last few overs in the World Cup final, he basically made the choice. Look, this is down to me. Either it's down to me whether we win or lose this thing. And so he showed immense responsibility for that. Drove himself right to the edge in doing so. That showed fantastic maturity. And it is interesting, you talk to people within the England setup, that there is a lot of love for him in that setup. And I think he's come through fantastically well.
And we're not going to be talking too much about the golf today. I've enjoyed the senior open at Royal Livingston.
Proper golf weather, that, wasn't it?
It was, absolutely. And it continues as it is right now. But just one moment for me that I wanted to ask you, knowing that you were coming in this afternoon, Michael, was about, again, the individual sport of golf, as you were talking about, that whatever happens now with Tiger Woods, that victory at the Masters is just such an important moment, I feel, in sporting history for a man to come back in there.
Absolutely. A couple of months earlier, he couldn't walk.
And I'm not sure, perhaps we've seen the best of him now, but having completed that return, that was so important. Whatever he does now, whatever his back can do or not do. well. Thanks for that, Michael, as well. And to Sean Derry with me here. We're going to look at the Tour de France. We're going to look at swimming and the other side of sport and the cheating that's going on at the moment. Live darts to come, of course, and Dan Dawson will guide us through that. And we've got cricket with Australia about to bat. We'll go to Sam very shortly. And as far as the Grand Prix is concerned, here's Graham Courtney.
All change, Mark. Lewis Hamilton currently running in third place. Why? Because it was the usual story. When it drops a shower, the last thing you want on are slick tyres. Guess what he had on at the time? Not as bad, though, as Charles Leclerc. Charles Leclerc did exactly the same thing a previous lap, and, well, he went off into the gravel. And the only thing is, you can tell with a bit of youth, he's decided to give it a right good go, and all he's done is spun the rear wheels, and the gravel has disappeared, and the car's been beached altogether. So Charles Leclerc is out. Lewis Hamilton is going, though. He's OK at the moment, and he's just getting the impression, do you know what, he's running in third place. Don't rule out Lewis Hamilton actually making sure he gets towards the chequered flag. He is that good when it comes to wet weather. But if it doesn't rain between now and the end of the race, you'd suspect that things might not get any better for him. Sebastian Vettel currently running in eighth place. He's just come in to change his tyres again. He started at the back, but after, 43 of the 64 laps, and judging by the time as well, I think we actually might run up to the two-hour limit on this race. But I just think there's going to be a twist in the turn between now and the chequered flag. So anyway, 43 of 64 laps completed, and Max Verstappen leads the German Grand Prix.
So what's the Australian target to beat England then in the T20 at Hove? Sam Allard.
After winning the toss, not being to bat, England posted 121 for 8. Eccleston, 17 not out. Marsh, 1 not out. Tammy Beaumont top scored with 43. But the second highest score of the innings was just 17. I don't think Australia bowled that well. Yes, they took the pace off the ball, but some of England's shot selections have been woeful, and they're going to need something special if they're to defend this total. Let's not forget, Australia posted 226 on Friday, and if England are going to win their first match of this Ashes series, they're going to have to defend 121. Australia's reply just underway, three balls gone, they've got 8 runs on the board. Healy and Mooney are at the crease.
Sam, thank you very much indeed. We're going to be looking at the Tour de France, at swimming and the Chinese situation as well. And in the last hour with Sean Derry and with Michael Calvin, we're back to the football and the big transfer news still to come in the Premier League as we get ever closer to the start of the new season. This time next Sunday, we'll be with you at the Community Shield at Wembley. Liverpool and Manchester City have full commentary to come on that one here on TalkSport.
Lunch, lunch. What are the options looking like?
Apparently, every lunch hour we polish off 70,000 bowls of soup.
Yonsville.
What about crispy chicken and bacon smothered with smoky barbecue sauce, cool mayo, not forgetting tomato and lettuce, all rolled up in a soft toasted tortilla wrap?
AKA the barbecue and bacon chicken one. Today's $1.99 wrap of the day at McDonald's. Live your best lunch. Served after 10:30 a.m. Participating restaurants only. Subject to availability. Rest of range available at regular price.
You hear that? Something's coming. A beast waking up after a long summer. Hopes and dreams. New foreign signings wearing gloves in August. Football is a beast and the beast is back. But could it be better? With 2 weeks of seismic offers from Sky Bet to kick off the new season, it could. Football's just around the corner and it's registering 19 on the Richter scale. Sky Bet. That's betting better. 18 plus begun.
you've got Chris Froome, who's, you know, their greatest champion and the greatest champion of recent times, although his future is entirely up in the air because we just don't know how well he's going to recover from his terrible injuries.
Gary, it's Mike Calvin here. I think we all revere dynasties within sport, you know, be they football or, you know, in this case cycling, as you say, 7 out of the last 8 tours by either Sky or Ineos. Is that dynasty a good thing for cycling, or is it something that probably needs to be eradicated?
It's not necessarily always a good thing to watch, although that hasn't been the case this year, because, and this sounds counterintuitive since they've got the first and second men on the podium, but Ineos were a lot weaker this year. They didn't control the race. You know, they usually put everyone on the front, suffocate the racing, set such a high tempo that nobody can attack, and it's a brilliant way to win a race. It's not necessarily a great way to create a spectacle. So this year they were weaker, but you know, it's an age-old question. I think it would be good if the glory was spread around a little more. And you know, if you're looking for it to be spread around a little more, and you think, well, at least Movistar won the Giro with their great Ecuadorian rider Richard Carapaz. Well, Ineos have signed him, so you know they've not just won the Tour de France; they've bought up the bloke who won the last Giro d'Italia. So. Yeah, they're dominant, and it would probably be better for cycling if they were a bit less dominant.
Well, thank you very much indeed for all of that, Gary. And that's Gary Imlach with looking ahead to how the tour is finished. And, you know, it's going to be a long way back for Chris Froome, whatever anybody says. I wonder if there's an opportunity to speak what's more to Graham Courtney, because there is chaos at the German Grand Prix now, and it involves Lewis Hamilton.
Absolutely. I mean, it's been one of those crazy, crazy races where it's all down to the rain. And, well, now the track is completely dry. The forecast is it's going to be dry now for the remainder of this race. But Lewis Hamilton, well, in the incident he had around about, 10 laps ago, he ended up with one of these situations where he's got to try and dive into the pit lane, and he came in on the wrong side of the bollard. And it's daft, really, because actually, if he wanted to go around the correct side, he'd actually had to go against the flow of the traffic. So he's gone the other side of it, but he's been given a 5-second penalty. So what's happened is he's coming to change his tyres, and he's just got to sit for 5 seconds, and then eventually the crew can actually work on it. But because the safety car has been out, all the cars are bunched up. So Lewis Hamilton at the moment is running in 12th place. But won't be surprised if other things happen as well. But Max Verstappen currently leading. Lance Stroll is in second place. Daniel Kvyat is in third. So it's a crazy leaderboard at the moment. And then you've got Valtteri Bottas. What about Sebastian Vettel? He's currently running in 9th place. But as I say, Lewis Hamilton, well, if it could have gone wrong this afternoon, it has. He's back in 12th place at the moment. But there might still be another twist in the tail. So we've got 14 laps to go. 50 of the 64 laps have been completed. And at the moment, Max Verstappen leads the German Grand Prix.
Well, England have taken their first wicket against Australia at home. Sam Allard.
Australia 23 for 1. Healy out for 20. It was a short ball from Brunt, which Healy looked to pull. Top edge, though, and Amy Jones takes a very impressive catch. But the 20 from 13 balls for Healy has got Australia off to a quick start. 14 runs came from the first over. At the crease now with Beth Mooney and Meg Lanning. Lanning, of course, made 133 on Friday. Unbeaten, it was an incredible innings. Australia 23 for 1. They need 99 from 100 balls.
Thank you, Sam. We're going to talk a little bit about swimming and darts before we get back on the transfer trail here on TalkSport.
The Wickes TraPro Sports Series. TalkSport is revved up and ready to hit the stadiums in a season-long series.
that might see him over the line to claim a second major title, his first major since that World Championship. But do not write off Michael Smith.
No.
He's superb.
I mean, we've talked down here this afternoon about the individual sportsman or woman and what they have to do and how they have to cope with it. And here, though, with, of course, this opportunity for a first-ever title, as you mentioned, for Michael Smith. I'm just wondering, though, whether Rob Cross's comeback in that semi-final has taken an awful lot out of him or has gone the other way and thought, this is my title after that.
Yeah, it's very difficult to tell, but, of course, what you've got to remember, and when he won that World Championship, he'd come through one of the greatest games we've seen at Ali Pali with Michael van Gerwen, went all the way to extra time in a last set, and he survived match darts, came through it. It was gone midnight by the time he beat him. Crucially, there was an extra day's rest there, of course. They got a New Year's Eve off, and they came back and played on New Year's Day against Phil Taylor for the World Final and £500,000. But Rob Cross just seems to be able to shrug off these things and go straight into the next game. I think he's going to perform like he did in the second half or the last third of that game against Daryl Gurney, which means that Michael Smith is going to have to be at his best, like he was against Glenn Durrant in the opening exchanges of his semi-final, when, quite frankly, he had a three-time world champion and he made him look ordinary. He was by far the better player, Michael Smith, for the vast majority of that game. We have got a match between two undoubtedly supremely talented players, but then guys who don't have a lot of big titles to their name just yet. It is a big, big day in both of these guys' careers.
Well, it certainly is, and Blackpool, of course, a great venue and a great atmosphere there tonight, and we've got it all for you here on TalkSport this evening. Dan, what's your own thought here? Who goes on to win this?
You know what, I think in the terms of the odds, this is about as close as it's ever been in the final of the Betfred World Match Play. That makes it so difficult to call. I do think that maybe Rob Cross is the man to look at. He is the narrow favourite in this, but whoever wins, we've only had 8 winners of this event in 25 years of holding it. Phil Taylor, of course, won it 16 times, but you've got to be a real top player, player for the ages to go and win the World Match Play. Whoever does goes down in history tonight. I think it's Rob Cross, but I think it could be close.
What time are they on the hockey?
It's going to be just after 7 o'clock, so I think probably with all the pre-match build-up and everything, Rob Cross has already arrived doing his media stuff. I would think it's probably going to be about 7:30 when we see the first dart.
Excellent. Dan, thank you very much indeed. Dan Dawson and all of the darts tonight with all the action and all the drama to come of that final in Blackpool.
World Match Play Darts Update on TalkSport with Selco. See selcobw.com to find your nearest branch. Selco's got it.
Well, we talk so much about sport and we talk about the high end of sport and everything that matters. And, of course, there is a grubby business, as there has been in cycling over many years and in various other Olympic sports. And none more so, again, than we've seen in swimming. Just recently in Korea, and the Chinese swimmer Sun Yang, the man who's obviously been found guilty in the past, and the stand made by other swimmers now not to share the podium with him when it comes to the photographs and everything, and Britain's Duncan Scott with his protest as well, and Craig Lord and Adam Peaty, who's come out and talked our world breaststroke champion as well about all of this and the cheating, and how you know, over 100 positive tests in this sport for young swimmers in China, and yet still FINA doesn't seem to want to learn a lesson.
Yeah, they're in three wise monkeys mode, aren't they? And I always find it very instructive when the reaction of a governing body is to blame the athlete for trying to protect his sport, which is what someone like Adam Peaty has done in speaking out on this matter. And almost we're at the stage where clean athletes have to take the initiative, because the administrators they haven't got the moral courage to take a stand, because they think it would interfere with, you know, the marketing strategy or whatever it is. I've got a lot of time for the athletes who do something which is completely out of character for a professional athlete, which is actually just to openly disrespect another professional athlete. And this is what, you know, someone like Duncan Scott did by basically refusing to go along with that charade of that medal ceremony. He picked up his medal, and I thought the the response of the Chinese swimmer, Sun Yang, was, let's be charitable and say, unbecoming of a champion.
Well, I mean, the disgraceful scenes afterwards when, you know, he's shouting at the various different people, and Duncan Scott, of course, who stood there firmly and what have you. And yet these things will continue. These Chinese swimmers and others who are cheats will continue to be able to deliver what they want.
Yeah, and we've got, you know, I don't want to obviously cast aspersions about this individual, but history tells us that state-sponsored athletic programs in whatever Olympic sport you're looking at, or, you know, if it's cycling, you know, commercially sponsored programs, they have a certain modus operandi, which is deny, 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 deny. And I think we're seeing this now. You know, there's a big furore in Australia at the moment. Another athlete has didn't even arrive at the games, and she is basically, you know, a story that we're all familiar with. And she says she can't understand how the PED got into her system. Well, that might be the case, but we've heard that story a million times before. I think the broader issue is, and we've talked about cycling so much in the past, is can a sport be credible if what you think you're seeing is incredible? And I think that's where we are with swimming at the moment.
Yeah, no, that's a really good point that you make.
And I say that in out of a lot of sadness, because you look at, you know, someone like Alan Peaty, who's a, you know, he's had a fantastic, his achievements have been fantastic. You know, I've been poolside at 4:30, 5:30 in the morning when these guys are out there every day trying to be better. Now, they're the ones who have been betrayed by the dopers.
Well, we've had it on all week. You know, my daughter is a, you know, she's a 13-year-old elite swimmer. You know, she's up, going up to Sheffield this week for the Summer Nationals. So, secondly, you know, it's become a brilliant sporting event in our house.
Yeah.
And my daughter's there as a 13-year-old young, you know, impressionable young girl, and she sees this. And we talk about heroes and role models. And you mention about, you know, when's it going to stop? When's it, you know, when are these companies who sponsor them? When are these, you know, these countries who back them? When are they going to put the foot down? But it has to be now, because I don't want my daughter seeing that. And I think the way that Duncan Scott handled the situation and the backing of Adam Peaty, that's testament to our Olympic swimmers and to our young boys and girls who are watching this. You know, when this fantastic World Swimming Championships that are on at this moment in time, I don't want my daughter seeing that, mate. I don't want that. You know, she's there every morning at 5:30. Her mum takes her every morning, gets up at 4:45, and then to go and be beaten by a cheat.
Exactly.
If that's going to be the case in 10 years' time, if she gets there, I'd not leave a sour taste in your mind.
Well, I mean, Sharon Davis told us all about this in her my sporting life recently, and everything, and her fight that continues too at the moment. And there are things again that we have to continue. Thanks very much indeed. So far to Graham. Courtney, we've got an hour left. We're going to be talking...
And you can see slogans of revolution of our times and waving the American flag and act calculated to provoke the authorities into doing something drastic.
The minister in charge of no-deal Brexit preparations says the government is working on the assumption that agreement with the EU is unlikely to happen. Michael Gove says a no-deal exit is on the cards because EU leaders say they won't be changing their approach. A Royal Navy warship has arrived in the Gulf to help British-flagged vessels pass through an essential shipping route off the southern coast of Iran. There have been growing tensions after Iranian forces seized one just over a week ago. And some parts of the UK have seen half a month's worth of rain in just 24 hours as the weather continues to cause travel disruption. The Met Office says more than 52 millimetres was recorded in Greenfield near Oldham.
Talk Sport weather
with QuickFit. Going on a road trip? Book your free vehicle safety check first at one of 600 QuickFit centres nationwide and drive away happy.
And the rain continues across northern parts of Wales, the Midlands and Northern Ireland through the remainder of the day. Drier elsewhere, though.
Talk Sport. Sports update.
With the new Vauxhall Combo Cargo. Now better than ever. With a payload of up to a tonne. Why not request a quote? Search Combo Offer.
Gareth Bale's proposed move to Chinese club Jiangsu Suning looks to have fallen through, and the Wales international is set to remain at Real Madrid. The winger had been expected to sign a three-year deal worth a reported £1 million a week. Zinedine Zidane had made it clear he was not Bale's biggest fan, and the player's
injury record. He has made just 79 Liga starts in the last four seasons. Didn't help his cause. But former Wales midfielder Carl Robinson tells TalkSport Bale must be getting frequent game time to be able to perform for his country.
Gareth Bale needs to play week in, week out. Aaron Ramsey needs to play week in, week out. These key players, Harry Wilson, the key players like this, they need to be playing regular football because you have them for 10 days during an international break.
Liverpool have brought in the Premier League's youngest ever player, 16-year-old winger Harvey Elliott, assigned from Fulham. Liverpool say he will be in their squad for this afternoon's friendly against Napoli in Edinburgh, which kicks off in just under an hour. Meanwhile, QPR assigned West Ham striker Jordan Hugill on a season-long loan. The 27-year-old found opportunities hard to come by with the Hammers after making the step up from Preston in January 2018. And cyclist Egan Bernal will become the youngest winner of the Tour de France in 110 years later on this afternoon. The 22-year-old holds the yellow jersey going into the final stage, which traditionally sees the leader go through Paris unchallenged. Latest sport every 15 minutes over on TalkSport 2, and there's more at TalkSport.com.
On digital radio and 1089 and 1053 AM.
Oh, what a wonderful effort from the edge of the area.
Sunday exclusive with Mark Saggers.
It's a quite brilliant goal.
On TalkSport, famous for football.
Well, time for us to take a good look at the transfer news here now on TalkSport in the last hour of Sunday exclusive. Alongside me, Sean Derry and Michael Calvin. We'll keep you right up to date with the cricket and with the Grand Prix, of course. It's a busy time. I mean, what are we, just a few days away now from the start of the championship.
sort all of these things out, Arsenal, again here, and it sort of teases the fans all the time, doesn't it, without getting anything done and then surprising everybody by announcing it.
No, and I suppose the sort of central weakness of the current transfer system is that it's designed to have to basically encourage brinkmanship, to do the deal at the last possible moment, even when maybe the season is underway. So, you know, you'll know, Sean, it takes 6 to 8 weeks to really bed a new player into a team. And so basically we're going to get to October before the players themselves understand how it's all going to work, how the system's going to work itself through. How, you know, the manager then will understand what his strengths and weaknesses that he's got to work with are. So it is it's no way to run a railway, this is it. The best clubs recruit in advance. They're looking 18 months ahead all the time. They get their business done early in the window, and they are then ready for the season. And Arsenal, like quite a few, are making up as they go along at the moment.
I'm with you. I thought, you know, when Emery came in and took over, you know, a ship that was disturbed with you know, a man who'd been there for 24 years, and then he comes in and he's kind of plugging gaps, really. And there was, you could sense there were short-term signings. And I'm with you. I think when you're looking forward in your recruitment, you don't just look forward for the next window. You look forward in two windows, three windows. You prepare. There's been no preparation for this window from Arsenal's side.
No, that's a point of view. Just one other transfer to talk about, and I'd like to talk about that right now as well, would be Liverpool and young Elliot from Fulham. Seen him in the Premier League. Lots of interest from lots of clubs. This is an important signing for the future again.
Which is as important as the signings for now. And Jurgen Klopp was obviously quoted yesterday as saying that you can't just throw millions and millions and billions at it. It's just unsustainable. What he's trying to create is, you know, he's got a fantastic group of players. And now for the next breed, the ones coming through, perhaps not now, you might find Elliot finds his way into the 23s. You know, he might go out and get a little bit of experience.
Have you seen anything very much?
Not really, no. But, I mean, you're not very really, unless you're an absolute Lionel Messi, you're going to put on a shirt in the Premier League at 16 years old.
Yeah. What you tend to do, you hear the names before you see the performances.
Absolutely, yeah.
So, and it's really interesting that he is only a kid. He's only six. Well, you've only got to look at his hairstyle to understand. You know, he's got a boy bum, which he's going to get slaughtered for when he goes into a senior dressing room, isn't he?
That'll soon go, yeah.
Yeah.
Sure.
But that group, that England 2003 group, is a very, very strong group. And it's also the time where, actually, they are almost the most valuable commodities in the transfer market when they're 16 and they're available. And so if you look at that group, Louis Barry has gone from West Brom to Barcelona. Liam Delap, Rory Delap's son, who's a striker, he's gone to Manchester City. There was a lad called Noah Ohio, great name by the way, who I think has gone to Leipzig from Manchester City. So there's almost a transfer market within a transfer market for these 16-year-olds, because big clubs now are cherry-picking these kids from at a very, very young age.
Let's go back to the cricket right now. Australia well on their way at the moment.
Palace the lead.
Zaha inside the penalty area, the angle's tight, he scores. And they are back in the game.
I honestly thought his heart was set on maybe going to Arsenal. Mm. Or the rumours now, maybe he'll stay at Palace, which I'd love to see. He'll stay at Palace at least till January or till the end of the season and go to Chelsea.
What I've heard, it's not a deal that is going to happen. I think Zaha would be a huge outlay for Everton.
Most of what's going on with Wilfred is going on between him and the chairman, and I can't enlighten you at all. You know, I know what you know, I guess.
Zaha bursts into the box down the right side, shoots at the goalkeeper who's mishandled it. It's through him and into the net, and Wilfred Zaha completes the famous victory for Crystal Palace.
He's a London boy. I think he quite likes the idea of being in London. And going to Everton whilst being a great football club is a departure into an area. He's been up north once before at a different time in his stage in his life at Manchester United. Money will talk in the end.
Zaha, 10 yards outside the area, takes on Klukas, comes into the box, rolls it one way, then the other, and around the outside, shoots, scores! What a brilliant goal by Wilfred Zaha, and he goes and celebrates in front of the Crystal Palace travelling supporters. Absolutely stunning goal from Zaha.
Sean Derry and Michael Cavan alongside me here this afternoon in the Taz through to the final word with Natalie at 5 o'clock. So it's not a mess, but it's one of these prolonged dragging out things. Where's he going to go, Sean?
When I'm with Simon Jordan on this, I'd be very, very surprised if he ends it, you know, in the northwest at Everton. Only on the basis that he is he just loves it down here. He loves London. You know, he's... You wouldn't believe how much he's adored around the streets of South London. He really is. He's just worshipped. I'd be so surprised if he ends up at Everton.
I think Everton have made a £55 million bid for him today.
I think he was probably scarred a bit by his experience at Manchester United, where, and this is how absurd football clubs behave sometimes, Manchester United bought him for, what, £10 million? He goes into his digs in Stockport, and he's essentially forgotten by the football club. And he's alienated, and he's in an environment he doesn't know. He eventually gravitates back to London, to that environment, as you rightly say, Sean, where he's revered in South London. He's almost like the granddaddy of the modern cage footballer. You know, these guys who hone their skills, a different set of skills in cage football. And, you know, I spoke to Jadon Sancho recently, and he comes back to South London and goes into the cages just to show off his tricks, you know, and his skills. So it's a different type of mentality for a footballer. And I think Zaha doesn't get enough credit for how he's almost not reinvented himself, but he's actually become a much more rounded player. I think probably the odds are on him staying in London. Now, it was mentioned in the clip there, Sags, about Chelsea. I think this is quite an intriguing one. Chelsea, in a way, have probably had the best window of the lot at the moment because they're growing organically. They have to because of the transfer ban. They've got Frank Lampard in, and to an extent, although, you know, you can never say never where chaos at Chelsea is concerned, but by and large, he's got a pretty free run at it this year. So if Chelsea were to do some form of deal with Crystal Palace, they can't sign him for two windows anyway, so they get him for next season, you know, the 2020-21 season, and basically he's loaned back, or there will just be some form of, you know, understanding that he will play for Crystal Palace for another season, and he will go to Chelsea at the end of that. I can see that happening.
I think that if you was to ask Wilfred his ideal outcome with this, I think that would be it. Because he loves Crystal Palace. He really does. And, you know, I'm sure if he does leave this... He does need to play at a top four club for me, with the greatest respect to Everton. You know, I think that's probably a deal that just creates some sort of leverage for one of the top four clubs to come in and sign him. And if it's going to be in that way, then he gets to say his goodbyes in the right and proper way. Because I think if he was to leave Crystal Palace at this moment in time, how do you replace Wilfred Zaha with 10 days to go, however long's to go in the window? I don't...
family have built up all the way for this and suddenly it doesn't happen. What does that take out of you as a player?
Well, we spoke about the mentality and the professionalism of Gareth Bale. You know, when you mentioned earlier on, Mike, about maximising your ability. I think that's what Maguire's done. I think he's absolutely maximised his own ability. I watched him as a young player at Sheffield United. I think to watch him then and to see where we're potentially seeing where he's going to go next, it's surprising. But that's where he's got. And he's got through there from his leadership skills. And that's what we're talking about now. And to go and source a leadership-type centre-half, you've got to pay a lot of money for them because they're not built like that no more, Saggers.
Oh, well, this is the other thing.
And that's why you've got to go into the 80 millions to go and get that.
And it's also to do with character.
Yeah.
You know, that is one of the key elements of recruitment, is this ability not to just to define technical qualities and tactical acumen, it's temperament. Who is this person who's going to walk through the door? And anyone who has worked with Harry Maguire speaks so highly of him, not as a player, not just as a player, but as a person as well. And I think that's really important. And I wouldn't blame, again, with the greatest respect to Leicester City and their fans, because I, like you, I think Leicester are going to have a great season this season. Mm. I think the recruitment has been terrific. And, you know, like any other football club, they will have, in Brendan Rodgers' back pocket, player plan A, player plan B, player plan C. So they will be able to act very quickly, I would guess, if Maguire goes. I don't blame Maguire for wanting to play for Manchester United because, you know, long, long time ago we were all kids and, you know, one of the fantasies of your schoolboy days was playing for Manchester United. It's a wonderful football club. It makes, it creates legends. And I think it's a perfect time for someone like Harry Maguire to go into Manchester United because they are, the expectation level at Manchester United is usually stratospheric. I think people are quite realistic about where they are at the moment. So actually, you could go in there and play a real role in almost like the rebuilding or the revitalisation of Manchester United. And I think that's a fantastic thing to do.
When I was at Leeds United, when they came out of the Premier League and spent the first year back in the Championship, I think we had something like 42, 43 players. And I'll get there in the end, but when you think about a club like Man United with the weight of the badge as well, it carries so much. Not everyone can play for Man United, even if you're a great player. I think by his temperament and his character and his personality, I think he's perfect for Man United at this moment in time. I see so many people who couldn't pull on the white shirt for Leeds because of what Leeds United was in the Championship back then. And it's similar to where Man United are now. They have fallen down off the top levels of the pecking because that's where they are. So it's...
Steve Bruce will be joining Sean Custis, Simon Jordan and Ian Holloway live on the programme. And a reminder that on TalkSport 2 from Tuesday, there's live racing from Goodwood. Here's the latest sports heads on TalkSport with Colin Besley.
Thanks very much. Good afternoon. Real Madrid look to have called off Gareth Bale's proposed move to China. The Wales winger was due to agree a three-year contract with Jiangsu Suning, worth a reported £1 million a week. Meanwhile, Liverpool have signed winger Harvey Elliott from Fulham. The 16-year-old made three first-team appearances last season. Elliott became the youngest Premier League debutant in history in May when he played for Fulham against Wolves. Meanwhile, West Ham striker Jordan Hugill has moved to QPR on a season-long loan. Despite starting from pole, a crash in a rain-affected German F1 Grand Prix meant Lewis Hamilton could only finish 11th. The eventful race in Hockenheim was won by Red Bull's Max Verstappen, with Ferrari's Sebastian Vettel finishing second, having started at the back of the grid. And Great Britain's men won gold in the 4x100 metres relay at the World Swimming Championships. That was the medley event. It was the third gold of the event for Adam Peaty. The British team's time is a new European record of 3 minutes, 28.1 seconds. The latest sports every 15 minutes over on TalkSport 2, and there's more at TalkSport.com.
TalkSport, stand by for live Premier League commentary capability.
Roger, 11. Both the pre-match build-up and post-game analysis are looking good to us.
And ignition.
Roger.
TalkSport, this is Houston. You are go for game day.
Ignition confirmed. Football is go.
The football has landed. TalkSport brings you a brand new season and a brand new Saturday. One small kick for football, one gigantic win for TalkSport.
TalkSport, your goal for game day. Game day is goal.
More live football than ever.
It's an absolute sitter.
Game day is Saturday football.
Starts 10th of August
on TalkSport and TalkSport 2.
Roger.
This is what real sport sounds like. Talk Sport.
Well, Michael Cameron and Sean Derry, let's go to Manchester United and Lukaku. Juve preparing an offer for him and willing to include Dybala as part of the deal. There's been all sorts of other bits and pieces. I don't know where we are.
Does anybody?
Yeah, well, he's going to go, or they want him to go, don't they?
Yeah, there's an old Fleet Street tradition called the come and get me plea. And, you know, that's basically, so it would read something like, Sean Derry last night offered a come and get me plea to Leeds United. You know, basically, I want to get out of this football club and I want to get out fast. Lukaku's taken it to another level by pointedly posing with his agent for social media yesterday. So it's obvious a deal of some sort is going to happen. It depends on what is convenient mutually, I suppose. The Juve one is interesting in terms of, one, it would mess up Inter's plans, so there's a domestic reason for that. Dybala, it looks like that they're going to say, is available. Tottenham are very interested, so if he went to Manchester United, that would obviously frustrate Spurs. So I think he will go, and I think in Serie A, I think he could be quite a weapon.
What do you think about Lukaku? Are you a for or against him at this very highest level?
I'm actually a for Lukaku. And, I mean, his goals per game ratio for Belgium is phenomenal. I think he's played 81 and he scored 48. And, you know, that's brilliant, absolutely brilliant return. But he scored 42 goals in 96 games for Man United. Now, the challenge is, what type of system are you going to play to get the best out of your goal scorers at Manchester United? If you're going to get young Daniel James, for instance, he's an absolute pocket rocket, gets on the outsides, drops his shoulder, gets balls into the box. That could suit Lukaku. However, if you're going to play wide players who rotate on the inside and want him to be part of that kind of process where you're firing it into him, he holds it up and he links with his wide players and his number 10, well, that's not his strength. So this all boils down to what system you're going to play. Is Ole Gunnar Solskjaer going to play your stereotypical wide player for Manchester United, get the ball on the outside and get it back in? Then Lukaku's going to score an absolute bag full of goals for you. But if you want him to be that creative type of number 9, then he's just not that. So, but what you can't afford to do at any level is lose goals out of your team. And Lukaku brings you goals. Whether you like him or you loathe him, he's got a great goals per game ratio.
You mentioned, you just touched on a little bit of where Manchester United are going to be this season under Ole Gunnar Solskjaer. There's an awful lot more sort of work still to do there, and the sort of scattergun approach from Mr. Woodward as far as doing all of these signings, everything, staying behind to get deals done and through and everything. It again smacks a little bit of they haven't planned this out.
That Manchester United they're in a stage where they're actually looking, I think, at the whole football club in terms of, like, Nicky Butt has been promoted to a new role, and recruitment will be part of that. Recruitment at Manchester United historically was the domain of Sir Alex Ferguson, and, you know, and his brother Martin was very influential in the scouting department. I found it quite intriguing that there's a story today that Sir Alex is very interested in John McGinn at Aston Villa, being recruited into their midfield, and I think John McGinn's granddad is a friend of Alex's. Fantastic player, he had a great impact at Aston Villa. Can he make that step up? And maybe what Manchester United need is a little bit of a balance. You need to bring in almost like the finished products, but also have someone like him again who would come in with huge hunger.
for one or two players as well. And where they sit in a similar position, you know, it's the excitement about the new stadium that's going to come through. They've had, you know, in recent years, this sort of they're going to be back up there, and then it's never quite happened for them. Is, you know, this week they've sold Lookman, haven't they? One of their youngsters who promised much but was sort of never quite in it, and what have you.
I think actually, in that case in point there, I think they made a mistake in allowing Ademola Lookman to go for a relatively small sum, £22 million to Red Bull Leipzig. I would expect him to thrive in the Bundesliga. What are they looking at? They've done good business in almost holding a player, André Gomes. They've basically kept him on now. There's some talk of $36 million for Moise Kean from Juve. They're one of the clubs who probably need that marquee signing.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, that's where we go back to Wilfried Sahar. I think they probably saw him as that sort of $60, $70 million.
This is where you can get caught out as well, can't you? If they continue to chase him, and then Sahar in the end decides, no, Everton aren't right, I want to stay in London, I'll go to Arsenal, whatever. This is the problem that clubs like Everton have these days.
Well, I think if you're an Everton fan, it's quite exciting because, I mean, we all saw the visions of the new stadium potentially taking place in 3 to 4 years. You know, what it could potentially look like in 3 or 4 years' time, and that's where you need your signings now to take you into that next level. And I think that's where they are. I think they're right on the brink, Sags, of being one of the top six clubs once again, because, you know, back in the day they was always up there, weren't they? You know, there was brilliant Everton sides, and with Marco Silva there now, they're probably saying, well, can he be the one who takes us into that next level? Personally, I'm not too sure in terms of Marco Silva being the one that takes them into the next level, but I think in terms of Everton as a football club, with this new stadium around the corner, that's exciting for an Everton fan.
I think also it's natural for us to focus on the coach, Marco Silva, but actually I think with Everton, to try and understand where Everton are at the moment, mm-hmm. trying to get to, you've got to understand the influence that is being wielded by the director of football there, Marcel Brands, who by job definition he's got a much longer term view, and it is how do we sort of almost ease our transition into that new stadium, and, you know, everything that will flow from that in terms of income, and then obviously their ambitions will have to match the infrastructure. So it's going to be really interesting to see if Brands can get any more. I think some of the Kane's a case in point. It's a really interesting transfer back. It's a gamble. But I think that a gamble like that could well come off. Young player, unfulfilled potential. Is it smart recruitment? It could be, or it could blow up in their faces, but I think that could be a smart move.
Yeah, that's a good point that you made with that. We'll come back and talk about Manchester City in a short while. Let's get all the news on that T20 between England and Australia at Hove with Sam.
Australia have won the second T20 by 7 wickets. They've chased 122 with 13 balls to spare. Perry 47 not out, landing unbeaten on 43. The fourth wicket partnership was something special, worth 87. In the end, all too easy for the Aussies, who go 12-2 up in the series. England did pick up 3 early wickets to have Australia struggling at 35-3, but Lanning and Perry showed their class to guide Australia home. Early this afternoon,
pressure on this kid by saying something like that. I've seen him, being groomed through the youth ranks and for England as well. You've got Pep Guardiola saying that this is the best player that I've seen, and he's yet to, basically he's being shielded from the England under 21s because he's not quite ready for that. Well, blimey.
Well, having said all that, he's been very clever with him, hasn't he, Pep? He hasn't needed him.
Well, he hasn't, but I think he's going to give him the opportunity.
But the club need him.
Yeah.
The club need, for this whole project to have relevance, to bring it all in, they need a homegrown player.
It's like Xavi Iniesta at Barcelona.
No, but he does need... But what he's... When I said that, I meant that they haven't needed him to push him in before Pep really wants to.
No, it's the right... It's timing, isn't it? This is the right time. He's took him away from, the first-team environment. He's put him back in at certain times. He's played his League Cup games for them. And obviously, David Silva is going to be retiring at the end of this season, so... It's brilliant recruitment from Manchester City, like for like, just like we've seen with the Rodri and Fernandinho deal.
What about some of the other clubs involved? Wolves are another one that really think that this sort of second season in now could be the right one for them. Their transfer policy and what have you, we know all about, don't we? And it's amazing that one or two players are quite happy to stay there as well.
Yeah, it looks like they're... quite a way down the line in getting Patrick Coutrone from AC Milan. They're almost going a bit like the Arsenal route in getting a loan signing from Real Madrid.